Welcome to Viewpoints. I'm Heather Isvron, and with me today is Al Teller.
Al is the former president of CBS Records, which is now Sony, and he also served as CEO with MCA Music Group, which is now Universal.
Thank you very much, Heather. Pleasure to be here.
You have an extensive background in academia as well. So you have a degree in engineering and applied mathematics from Columbia, and you also went to Harvard for that MBA.
That is correct. I have a lot of equations stuck deep in my mind.
So that's really interesting because you have the music background and then you have the academics, and now you're working with startup groups.
Yeah, one of the interesting things from my perspective anyway over the course of my career is using all that quantitative education that I had both as an undergraduate and graduate student, and yet spending my career in a business which at its core is all about instinct and feel and making leaps of faith and assumptions about the musical tastes of our audience and the capabilities of our artists. So combining both, I guess, left brain and right brain thinking has been a sort of an interesting journey over the last number of decades I've been at it. And applying all of that to young startups to help them get out of the starting gate and up and running as quickly as possible in terms of the mission that they have assigned to themselves.
Let's talk about the music for a second. So
sure.
You spent decades working with artists and the intuitive part of this. So talk about why music is important.
One of the things I like to say about music is that it hides in plain sight. It's with us everywhere, every day, so people tend not to notice it in its full ramifications. But if you want to focus for a moment on young people and what influences young people and their thinking, there's nothing that influences them more than music. This is something we've studied through many market research studies over numerous years. And if you can identify the musical tastes and interests of a young person, you will see how it affects his or her attitudes about clothing, friends, lines of thinking, other interests beyond music. So you could tell a great deal about a young person simply starting using as your starting point their musical interest and what they're listening to and what their friends are listening to. Music is also a great bonding agent.
Mm-hmm.
Groups gather together, friends gather together, and often the central focus of that is the music they all have in common, that their likes. So I would suggest that in terms of your line of work and your colleagues' line of work, that studying music and its influences among young people could yield very important benefits.
And so when we are talking about a possible radicalization through music, have you seen that across your travels in the world? Have you seen any kind of the using the music as an influencer, whether it's gangs or Middle East?
Well, yeah, I see the same thing that most everyone sees on television in terms of reportage about what's going on in the Middle East these days, and the use of videos, the use of rap-oriented videos as tools of radicalization. That is fairly common right now, and that should be studied carefully by the folks who are responsible for taking care of action in this arena. And I believe there's a counter-narrative that could be put in place using the same basic techniques of music and videos, but doing it, frankly, in a far superior fashion and delivering a much more powerful counter-narrative. I think that's an area of investigation that I think could prove extremely helpful and useful.
Certainly the intelligence folks can use it as a primary way of understanding their person. I mean, when we're talking about social media and going on perhaps Facebook, or you can just look at Spotify and their music selections, correct?
Yeah, it will certainly give you some initial clues as to the mindset of an individual. It's an incredibly powerful mechanism. I've seen hundreds if not thousands of performances of artists all over the world over a number of decades, and it's amazing how uniform the reaction is of a young audience to a performer they're seeing on stage. It's the same around the world. People respond to the artists that they like. They're enthusiastic about it. They show their appreciation, their enthusiasm. They share it with their friends. It's a tremendously powerful influence. And again, if I were to try to add up all the young people I've seen at concerts over the years, it's in the tens of millions. And this is the same kind of reaction that is repeated time and again.
And what do you think is important about the messaging within songs? And does that make people more violent, less violent? Have you seen both?
I'm not going to pretend to be a psychiatrist or a social scientist in the least, but I'll just speak from my own experience. I spent the decade of the 60s in college and graduate school, and the 60s, as you well know, was a decade of enormous social change and upheaval in many ways. And the music of that time was extremely important in that process. It was part of the whole feedback loop. The Bob Dylans of the world, the Joan Baez's of the world, there were the Beatles, so many artists, their songs, their performances inspired a generation of young people to express themselves politically and to become quite active in a number of movements, be it the civil rights movement, the pro or con in terms of the Vietnam War, social injustice. It was an incredibly powerful mechanism, and it was a great spur to action for an entire generation of young people.
So now we're in the 2015. What would you say is the overarching feel of this decade of music?
The world has changed so dramatically in terms of the rise of social media, Twitter, Facebook, and many other social media platforms. The availability of music as downloads and as streams. The communication world is so much richer, so much denser, and so much more fractionated than it was decades ago that it's difficult to make those same sort of overarching conclusions. And there aren't nearly as many worldwide superstars as there once were, and their lifespan as worldwide stars is much shorter than it used to be.
Right. So what makes a person influential in music, would you say?
That gets to the heart of the challenge of the music business. You know, what is that special magic that an artist has? It's a combination of their lyrics, of their sound, and of who they are, the way they project in their live performances, and their believability. The connection that an artist makes with an audience has to be based on a true sense of believability. You as an audience member, you're watching the performance of an artist and you're saying to yourself, I believe what he is about or she is about or what they are about. I'm responding to that. They're speaking to me. They're speaking to something within me, and that's why I'm responding in kind. But it's still a very instinctive kind of thing. There are no convenient equations or mathematical models to describe it.
So when you're talking about just music as propaganda and, you know, just putting a message out there, there has to be some kind of authenticity behind it. Otherwise, it's kind of disposable.
When you say music is propaganda, if you try to consciously do it in that form, people will know it's that. They will instinctively know that there's no authenticity behind it. And one of the absolute essential requirements to become a star, and certainly a superstar, is that you have to be real. You have to be authentic. Because if the audience doesn't think you are, they will reject you. And so anything, any message that might come out of an artist's music has to be a message of authenticity. If you go out of your way to try to deliver a message and it's not your natural mindset, the kids will know it. Young people will know it.
Right. And so if there's, let's go back to the gangs for a second and how they try to message. You were talking a little bit about that, how they use songs to influence their communities.
Yeah, well, if you look at the whole rap phenomenon that grew up in the inner city decades ago and has gone through various changes and iterations, initial rap was really very positive messaging, and it was a message of hopefulness. It was a message descriptive of the situation in their communities and what their ambitions and their desires were. It then sort of splintered into various different elements, including the gangster rap component that came up, and that was incorporated by a lot of, you know, gangs both on the East Coast and the West Coast, and there was that conflict between East Coast rap and West Coast rap. And then it merged, it morphed again into more of a hip-hop, more commercial sound. I remember colleagues telling me in the early days of rap, when we got involved with Def Jam at Columbia Records, that this was not going to last very long, that this will be over and done with in fairly short order. Well, I would submit that these people were profoundly wrong. It, you know, rap, hip-hop is as interwoven in not only American culture but world culture, into the core fabric of what culture is about, that it's not going away. And when you see, if you were to watch television and you see major companies, be they food companies or automobile companies, all using rap as the music underbed for their commercials, you know that this has been accepted and woven into the mainstream of American and world culture in a complete fashion. But there have been those times where elements of rap have been used to, you know, for nefarious purposes, but just in the same sense that, you know, the same is true for rock music, for heavy metal. You know, you could identify any aspect of music, and it could be, you know, turned for negative purposes or for positive purposes or just for pure entertainment purposes. Same could be said for all aspects of culture, books, magazines, television, films, etc.
Well, it goes back to your point that music is so pervasive and we all do it, and you can listen to it anytime doing anything.
One of the very unique characteristics of music as compared to any other medium, you can listen to music while basically doing anything else in life. You can listen to your favorite songs literally thousands of times, and it still will excite you on the 1,001 listening as it did on the very first listening. It's one of the really amazing aspects of music. You cannot watch your favorite film 1,000 times, or read your favorite book, or even your favorite poem that many times, but there's something about music that allows itself to be repeated and enjoyed time and again, indefinitely. I still listen and get excited about songs that I first heard back in the 60s when I was an undergraduate, and I still react to them in the exact same way. And that's just true for people in general.
It just sounds like we haven't tapped the potential of music as a message in the Homeland Security realm. And it would be exciting, and I know the students are excited to hear and to start thinking about that in a more meaningful way.
I think that's a really important point. And I would say, because music is such a powerful medium, again, on a worldwide basis. And when I say to young people, music is powerful for everyone. However, young people, teenagers, young adults, really use music as almost the central core of their whole interaction with other people, and it's a binding agent. But I think in general, tapping into all the instinctive arenas of human life, be it music, art, films, poetry, they offer the potential, a very powerful potential, to be a force of counter-narrative and to deliver a message, an important message, a positive message to the youth that at this point is possibly attracted to some of the really difficult elements that are currently at play on the worldwide stage. And I would strongly suggest that this is an area worthy of pretty serious inspection and research.
Well, we're excited to have you here at the center, and we're looking forward to the ways that we can use music in Homeland Security to affect change.
Well, it's my pleasure and privilege to have been invited to participate with you and your colleagues, and once again, I thank you very much for the invitation.
Thank you.